Streamlabs to catch up with me. What kind of whiskey we drinking?
Just some bullet rye or bullet bourbon.
Nice.
You know, lower mid shelf, cheap. You can find it anywhere. Cheapish, I should say.
I'm always a big fan of bullet rye. It's a nice go-to, and you can find it pretty much anywhere, so.
Exactly. I typically, this is my go-to, my favorite, but I don't want to drink it all. Larceny. Yeah.
I see you're a man of good taste.
Yeah, I got the drink cart right here. That's some of it, at least. There's a whole nother layer down there.
I wouldn't doubt it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, guys, bys, and non-conventionally identifies, we are here with the one and only 18 bunnies in a guy-shaped suit, Januaryandon. What's going on? Welcome to the podcast, homie. How you feeling today?
I'm good. I just got off work. Work is okay. I mean, I get to work from home, so it could be way worse, right?
Amen to that. Been working from home myself for the first time in like 10 years for the past like 4 months. It took some getting used to. And by getting used to, I mean I had to find a couple extra outlets to plug shit in at home. So like, no, you can't use your own computer. And I'm like, what do you mean, dude? I work in a call center. I will have the best call quality out of anybody. Do you understand what I do for a living outside of you fucks?
So I'm really surprised at how. Never mind. I can't say this. Never mind. I retract. I retract.
Crazy times, man. Crazy times.
I know. It's this is the first time I've experienced anything like this in my life.
I think that goes without saying for a lot of us here. But since we can't really do the whole, you know, stream get-togethers and meetups and shit, that's why we have lovely things like podcasts and the internet where we can hang out and shoot the shit. But for those of you that don't know this lovely lad sitting beside me at the moment, Januaryandon and I have we've been kind of chilling here and there, raiding each other's channels for a bit. Fellow Soulsborne streamer, but I'm not going to sit here and try to fluff his own ego. He can do it himself. Jao, why don't you tell us about yourself a little bit?
So, my name is Januaryandon. You can call me Jao, much like the young Pip did. I'm a fellow broadcaster. I've been on Twitch for 2 years now, streaming, just about maybe a month or two, give or take. I primarily play third-person action RPGs, but I'll fit something else in there every now and then. I drink a lot. I make cocktails, which is the thing I'm most proud about with my broadcast. And, that about sums up the game.
Now, that was one of the things that kind of drew me to him. I mean, we've been kind of joking around about it, amongst ourselves here, Jao. But Twitch's best bartender over here. You might have seen on Twitter him make his famous Estus cocktail, which we actually made on stream a couple nights ago. And it was
very cool.
Absolutely fan-fucking-tastic. I don't remember much of that night, but I do remember it was tasty.
Yeah, that cocktail was actually kind of an experiment, because that was the first cocktail that I've really done the lore, that I've like tied the lore of what I was playing. Traditionally, if I'll do a game style cocktail, I'll look for something thematically or even like, you know, kind of tangentially connected, and I'll base the craft around that. But with the Estus cocktail, I chose the spirits thematically. I chose the glass thematically. I mixed it in a way that I connected to the lore of the game. I brought in burned meat into a cocktail. It was the first time I'd ever tried that. And I really wanted to make this one work in a way where something I found, because if we would have had this interview a year ago, what I would tell you is, oh yeah, I make good cocktails that I can teach you how to order at a bar. And while I think that has its place, most people don't really want to fucking watch it. They don't need to be told, you know, what drinks to order at a bar, because they don't care.
Right. I mean, if you're going out to a bar, you're kind of either looking to hook up with somebody or just get fucking smashed.
Yeah. And what I found is, I have a crew of people that are like, hey, you know, I just like watching the cocktail mixing. That's really fun.
Oh, yeah.
That's really enjoyable. But numbers wise, metric wise, and I run a really expensive show. I do not have a cheap broadcast compared to, I think, the average streamer.
Well, you got the overhead cost of keeping a bar stocked. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, what the. So we did a front page stream.
Which
and
was
because,
awesome. Oh my God, I was so hyped for that.
But like I'm using more than a couple ounces per thing, so I'm buying full liter or half liter bottles. I think that one was like $400 in just the bottles I had to buy. The Tifa Lockhart Final Fantasy VII stream, that was $270 plus the cosplay outfit.
If you haven't seen that, guys, you need to go. Absolutely best Tifa Lockhart cosplay. It was hysterical. Go watch the VOD if you haven't.
Yeah, I got really lucky with that one. That one went out really well. But anyway, it's just so the reason I bring up this cost is because I do kind of have to care about metrics if I want to put this much effort into it. If I don't want to put this much effort into it, that's fine. But if I want to make, you know, cocktails that have unique ingredients, that should cost money. And so I kind of got to care about the metrics. And what I found was that if I can tie it to a game, even if you don't care about drinking, you're like, okay, well, I want to know what's going on here. I want to know what this person thinks. I want to know what's going on. How does this work? And it worked.
Yeah, and that's kind of one of the things that's really unique about your stream, and honestly something that I'd always thought about but never really wanted to ask you, like, while you were live. I'm like, how the f*** does this guy afford all of these goddamn drinks? Like, is this dude just, like, made of money? Is he fucking old Wall Street, just got lucky and tapped out early? Like, so as far as when you first started coming up with game-based cocktails, what were some of the things that you would look for in a game that would actually give you some inspiration for a drink?
I want to think of the first one. It was really stupid.
That's sometimes where the best ideas come from.
Yeah. This game Temtem had just come out. It's like it's
that,
a humble
Pokemon MMO kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Kind of like Pokemon MMO. And I actually went really hard into it. And I think if the game had a little bit more on launch, I probably would still be more of a Temtem focused creator. But there was this one Tem that I don't even remember the name, but it's like this blue fat unicorn.
Okay.
With like this kind of like corkscrew looking nose and like a fluffy butt. Like it has like a cloud on its butt. And I was at the supermarket, and there are these stupid, disgusting drinks, by the way, called like, oh, what are they called? Like, I don't know, but they look like these little balls, and they've got like mojito, all sorts of shit. Like any flavor you can think of, like they're just these little like pre-made cocktails in these little round containers. And I was like, they had one that was kind of bluish, and like, that reminds me of that Tem. And I was like, wait a minute, I have a glass that looks like that. I could make a drink that color, get some cotton candy, use sugar water to make the cotton candy stick around the rim of the glass. And then I could easily just put in a twist of orange peel to represent its like kind of like corkscrew nose.
Okay.
And so I was like, okay, so now I got to think, what blue cocktails do I know? And then I started going through the list, and I was like, okay, well, it's a cute, sweet looking Tem. So how can I make this work? And I had gone so far initially, because my wife is very artistically talented, I had her like decorating the glass with the face with like a chocolate spread.
Oh,
and
nice.
She's like, this is too much. This is too much. There's no way you can do this live. You're going to smear it. It's not going to work. We need to scale it back and think more about the drink and less about its own appearance. Because if you give it one or two really defining characteristics of the creature, that will, like, human brains automatically try and make connections like that. And she's like, that's enough. You just need to get those. And so that's what we did. Yeah, it ended up popping off pretty well. We did one more Tem. And then I was kind of in a spot where Temtem wasn't... The only thing you could do is hunt for shinies, or save money, which meant catching and releasing Tem. That's all you could do, is catch and release Tem for hours at a time. And for, I don't know, 20, 30 hours, that was doable, but I started getting really damn bored.
Oh, yeah, naturally.
Yeah. And so I had always wanted to kick up Monster Hunter. Iceborne had just come out. And so I was like, you know what, we'll jump into that. And that was really cool. And then I ended up making a themed cocktail with Monster Hunter. And it was pretty cool. It was the first large scale cocktail I had made. I actually found this it's about like that big, flower pot. And I made the cocktail out of that. So it was like a group punch style cocktail. And I drank the whole thing. I got so like, I was so gone. That stream.
Oh man.
But that was the one where I was like, okay, how can I thematically tie this in? Where can I look for these defining features? And that was when I made the connection that there are fandoms, and fandoms exist where what they like is artwork and content for their fandom. They don't have to like that medium per se, right? They just like artwork of their fandom. And that's like, okay, well, look, maybe I can take better pictures of this. Maybe I can get some better lighting. And so now it's evolved for where it's not only a live presentation, where I try and make that live scene good and enjoyable. Now I end up making the cocktail again, but shooting it under different light, getting different pictures, and kind of like trying to use that content in more ways than one.
Yeah, that's always a key for content creators, is not really finding ways to like recycle your content, but just finding different ways to present it that makes it easier to consume for some people that may not have even found it. And for some of us in chat, we're mostly a Monster Hunter based stream, so I could hear a few people in my head just fucking cheering when you said Monster Hunter, which is one of the things where you and I kind of really got along with. We met over playing Dark Souls, not together, but I was just like, let me see who else is playing Dark Souls. I'm like, this guy's got fucking bunny ears on his headphones, and he's making drinks, and he's playing Dark Souls. How can I not like this guy? Let's just go. Yeah. Let's go hang out with him. We have a quick question in chat. Khaled Vor asks if it was the Safi Punch.
Yeah, that's my mod. He's he's been a part of the stream since.
I thought the name looked familiar.
Like month two of streaming.
Hey, those are the good ones, man.
Yeah, and he's a fucking rock star. I feel
big shout out to the mods, by the way. You guys are true homies.
Yeah. I am lucky to have that man in my life.
Now, so you went from Temtem to straight into Monster Hunter from there?
Well, so I've, let's see, what is my content creation journey? The original stream, my very first stream and my first streams for a year were based around this game called Dauntless, which is a free-to-play Monster Hunter-style game that is now available through the Epic Game Store. And I found that game when I was living in South Korea three and a half years ago. And I had just quit Overwatch. That game came out and I played it. And I met some people in Australia, and I really liked them, and we were hanging out. And at the time, there was the entire dev team was like 30 or 40 people, if that. But they were really active on Twitter. And so I was like shit posting with them on the regular. It was a closed beta at this point. Like getting in, you either had to purchase, get a key by random, or there were some other ways.
I was going to say, because I played Dauntless by buying into the beta.
Yeah. And I remember one of the reasons why I realized why I liked the developers of this game is like they put out an open call that says, hey, send us a GIF. The best GIF gets a beta code. And like I sent it was this goat mounting another goat. And then when that goat thrusts, it hard cuts to like another the other goat flying away, like getting shot like a missile. And they just like cold DM'd me a code from that, and I was like, okay, so these guys are ridiculous. These guys get it.
These guys are just extra.
And so I started making sure I was like interacting with them on Twitter, and then by the time I actually flew back home to Washington State, I was pretty invested in the game. A lot of the developers knew me by at least January and on. And then I started meeting some of my closer stream friends that also streamed the game. And they were like, well, January on, when are you going to start streaming? And so I was like, well, you know, let's give it a try. And so I started with Dauntless, and that I streamed basically nothing but Dauntless for probably a year, maybe longer. And that's when I started branching out, which included Monster Hunter, Temtem, Destiny 2. Jesus.
we actually just started getting back into Destiny, our little crew over here.
Mm-hmm. Well, Destiny 2 gave me nothing but technical issues, and it almost killed my channel.
Oh, man.
So I have... I have a hate-hate relationship.
I'll drink to that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, man. So how did you find, as far as you transitioning from game to game like that, so Dauntless was the bigger part of the start of your streaming career.
Mm-hmm.
What were some of your, I guess we could say fears when you decided, hey, look, I'm going to make this transition from the only game I know to other things. What were some of the things that were going through your head as like, I could fuck this up?
Well, so, you know, we talked about like the booze and the cost of the channel. Now, the channel does okay, but I do have a full-time job that pays the bills, right? And I've always, I know, I guess most people have a number in their head, and I do as well, but like the chances of me ever going full-time streaming are so fucking minor. I have a wife who deserves somebody who can make sure that she's taken care of. God forbid anything happened for her job. And I don't feel like I'm in the spot where that's ever going to happen. So I've always told myself that it doesn't matter. The channel could die. I could walk away from this. Saying that and actually believing that are two different things. I initially just did a full cold hard switch from what was the content? I think it was straight to Monster Hunter. Or maybe it was Temtem for a little bit. I don't remember anymore. And the idea was like, you know what? Maybe I can get by on me being a content creator and not just the game. And the fear was that I wasn't good enough as a creator, that I couldn't maintain an audience without the help of Dauntless. I'm a Dauntless partner, so I get some pretty good perks for being involved in that game. I'm still pretty well connected to the developers, and I still play the game enough to keep my benefits, so I can fall back on that. But to be quite honest, when it came to Monster Hunter World, when it came to Destiny 2, when it even came to Temtem a bit, and some of the other kind of maybe one-off games we tried, I wasn't good enough. I tried to... I had gotten pretty lazy with Dauntless because I had baked in subscriber benefits that I didn't have to work on, because if you subscribe to me when I play Dauntless, you get a lot of extra bonus shit. I didn't think about what other things I could bring to the show. I realized that one of the reasons why Dauntless works so well is I can practically play that game with my eyes closed. I've got several thousand hours into it. And so when you've got that much experience, I don't even need to look at the game. I can look at the camera. I can do blindfold runs. I can do all this silly, stupid shit.
Oh, that's funny. I just started doing channel points for 5 minutes of hunting blind on Monster Hunter. And let's just say it didn't really go that well.
Well, yeah, but I mean, the difference is, like, in Monster Hunter, I guarantee you, your blindfold run, even if it fails, it will be more interesting and more will get done than if you kicked up Doom and just tried to blindfold that.
Right.
Right. The controls would be unfamiliar. You'd be doing things you don't know. Right. Like there's an amount of muscle memory that you don't lose even if you're blindfolded.
Clock in a good couple thousand hours and some things are just automatic. Yeah.
Exactly. And so what I realized, and I didn't realize this probably toward the end of my time streaming Monster Hunter World, is I need to be better. Like, gameplay can be poor, but I need to be a better entertainer. And that's when I looked back at the things I was doing, because I was trying to do the same thing in these other games that I was doing in Dauntless, and it wasn't working. And I needed to broaden my horizons. I needed to take more risks.
Yeah, that's one of the scarier things when it comes to content creation. Because, I mean, like you said, I mean, at some point, I have a full-time job myself, but streaming, I've been streaming for about the same amount of time as you, about 2 years. And it grew from just a way for me to hang out with my friends because I had a really weird work schedule. And I was like, oh, hey, you know, I can do this whole streaming thing and we can play games together and it'd be cool, into everything I never expected it to be. And as much as I could say, like, hey, you know, I'd be good if I just had to walk away from it, there's those things that you eventually, or at least that I've gotten out of streaming, that the days that I'm not live, I'm just like, damn, I cannot wait to click that go live button again and hang out with this person and that person and raid this person after stream and shoot the shit with them. And streaming
definitely
is just a very weird and interesting social media platform in certain ways. Because, I mean, like, for me at least, I'm a bit of an introvert. I hang out with very, very select people who have very similar interests as me. Because, like, I play Monster Hunter. I play card games. Half of my interests are on this wall behind me. So it's just kind of... There's small groups of people that I hang out with on a regular basis when I can. So for me, when this whole quarantine thing hit, I was just like, okay, we're going to keep doing the same thing we always do, man. We're just going to stream. Mm-hmm. We're going to hang out with people and it's going to be okay. And then it kind of dawned on me, like, wow, that's kind of sad to think about. Like, you're just cool with sitting in the house all the time. And I'm like, actually, wait, no, fuck that. These other people are like having panic attacks across my street. My neighbors are like, oh my God, I can't go out. I can't go to the bar. I can't do this. I'm like, dude, go. Like, go hop on a Twitch stream and, like, just shoot the shit with people.
Well, that was definitely something that I never, like, thought about initially, but obviously ended up happening. You know, you always have, there's always, like, that mix of I'm focusing on this content, but I'm also trying to focus on being this person that you can connect with at the same time. And that's another thing with the games. That's where the game selection can get in the way of that. That's ultimately, tech issues aside, why I gave up doing Destiny 2. Because I was doing a lot of the PvP. I found that to be the most fun. But once I played PvP, I became innately focused on the video game. And I was playing a video game and I happened to be streaming, not I was making content that I was streaming live to people while playing a video game.
Right, right.
And so it was like this, this understanding of like, there's certain games that I can play and certain games that I won't ever play again. And
you kind of have to make that decision of like, is this going to be entertaining because of my skill level at this game?
Mm-hmm.
Or do I want to present myself more as a content creator where when I type in chat, I'm talking to the person that's staring at this webcam, not not the esports god that's sitting in a chair and happens to be in front of the screen.
But yeah, and that's another thing that I talked to about.
And apparently playing full pistol missions, too.
Well, so I went only sidearms in Destiny 2.
Sidearms get the job done sometimes, though, Cal.
Yeah, I mean, so I did it on purpose because I realized, you know, one thing I realized with the bunny ears is you get a nice visual. And if you don't know, these are what I typically wear on stream, these cute little bunny ears. They're kind of breaking and I got to fix them, but...
Oh, no. Save the bunny ears.
I realized if I threw those ears on, made myself big, I am inherently going to get people who are like, what the fuck's going on here?
Right.
Like, what's this shit? I need to know.
That's how we found this guy.
And I want to say a philosophy, but a train of thought from a very, very talented streamer called DaBest Jared. And he says, your job, if you're looking to grow, is to make your thumbnail so you will get the click. That's your first job. So when you go to a browser source or when you browse a directory in Twitch, you know, you have 100, 200, 5,000 sometimes, depending on the game, other thumbnails there. How do you make sure that you get the click? So that is, even though we don't get to design that thumbnail because it's a random cross section of our stream, you have to think about your stream to make sure you get the click. And so in Destiny 2, it was the largest directory I had ever tried being in. So once I decided that I was going to start streaming Destiny 2, I was like, okay, I've got my ears. I'll put this cute big pink logo with my name on it. Now I've got ears, pink logo, and a giant red beard or a big red beard. There's a lack of fit there that is visually kind of interesting. What else can I do? And I was like, well, everybody hates sidearms. All the information I got when the game started was, oh, sidearms are trash. Sidearms are trash. I'm like, fine. I'm going to play competitive with two sidearms and I'm going to do a good job. And that's what I did. Man, I played ranked. I'm trying to remember the ranking system. I got the recluse, which is, I think, like a mid tier or a mid-level competitive reward. Like you have to get a certain rank.
Yeah.
And I got that just using the sidearms. And I was pretty happy with it. I did pretty well. I routinely had people who would stop by the stream and go, why the fuck are you using sidearms? And I'm like, well, there you go.
Let me show you.
So I started putting that in the title and that went really well. This stuff just kind of went on from there. And I don't remember how we got here, but that was kind of some of the philosophy that I got going on.
Now, as far as your content outside of Twitch, I mean, you and I are fairly active between each other on Twitter recently, especially now that we've been hyping up this moment right here. As far as between Twitter and Instagram, what are some of the things that you found on other platforms that were either a challenge for you or that you found like it came as a surprise to you that were completely different than the content you create on Twitch?
For me, it ultimately came down to time. I've got a YouTube channel. I think it's got like 500 subscribers or something. It's never had a good upload schedule. Mostly because I'm a really slow video editor.
Same.
I am not I am not very talented at editing. I don't have time to play a lot of games off stream, so I don't have a lot of time to record games off stream. And so what I found was, like, I would try and fit these moments for videos when I could, because, you know, I was like, oh, you got to do YouTube to grow. You have to be able to do YouTube. And I tried that for, I don't know, probably a solid year. And I just never got the, the effort, or I never really saw the fruits of that labor. And there are a couple reasons for that. Some of them are my fault. Some of them aren't. One being, you know, my two biggest influences, my two biggest reasons to, you know, go so hard into YouTube are two of my very good friends, Revy Rad and Odo. They're both full-time Dauntless creators. They have 40 hours a week to stream, edit videos, upload. I don't. Like, I don't right. have the time to do that. That's a lot of time. And, you know, I was working with them, and we still talk a lot, but I wanted to kind of, like, you know, I saw they were getting success there. I was like, well, maybe I can do it too. And what I ended up doing was I ended up sleeping less, producing more mediocre videos, and I saw no return on that effort. So I ultimately just stopped it. I'll put out one once or twice a year, maybe. But that's I'll find a topic that I'm really inspired on, and I do it for me, for my own professional development. I don't do it to hope that it gets anything out of it.
Right. Yeah. One of the things in terms of Monster Hunter. So I had just gotten back from Monster Hunter Festa and the World Championship Speedrun contest, and I was like, hey, you know what? I'm completely invested in the Monster Hunter franchise. I've been playing it since Monster Hunter 1. I love the community. I want to start kind of giving back to it. So I started doing build guides for all the different support variants that you could do in Monster Hunter. And ultimately, those videos took off. My support hunting horn video hit 1,500 views the month it was posted. And I was like, what the fuck is happening? I was like, dude, this is great. Like, you have to keep up with this. And then I realized, like, in order for me to create that video, that was 129 hours of editing for a 20-minute video. Yep. And I was, like you said, I was losing sleep over it. There were days that I literally just had to cancel the stream. I'm like, guys, I have to finish this video. And I'd had a solid upload schedule for a month straight, and it was fantastic. I was really feeling like I was at least gaining traction over in YouTube, but none of that was really converting over to Twitch just yet. And sure, if I had more time and I could have put more effort into it, preferably without losing sleep, it might have gotten somewheres. But right now, it's been about a month and a half, almost 2 months since I posted a video, and we're just kind of working on figuring out some of the ways that I could easily basically build a YouTube video into a stream, so that it's just boom, grab the recording off my hard drive, throw a couple of things of spit and polish on it, and then upload it.
Yeah.
And I mean, thankfully for me, on Fridays is kind of my downtime, where I'm not having to be fully engaged and having to manage a bunch of people, because I play a lot of community games. We do Tekken 7 on Tuesdays, as you know. We do Monster Hunter on Sundays and Mondays. So it's a lot of community management on my end. And I'm so thankful for my moderators that are over there in chat. Love you guys to bits, because a lot of times they help wrangle everybody together. And if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be able to manage half the knuckleheads that come into my Discord and shoot the shit with me on a regular basis. Everybody really kind of comes together on that. But on the other days, I'm just like, I really don't know how to handle 5-10 people in a Discord, and we're all trying to coordinate and do one thing. And we just got it back into going through the old Destiny raids too. And I was just like, it's only 6 people. What's the worst that could happen?
I know.
I'm used to having a dozen people in my Discord on Tekken Tuesdays, and all I have to do is open my mouth, and most people are respectful enough, like, hey, this guy needs to say something. We should probably listen. But oh my god, the degenerate fucking debauchery that happened when you get 6 people together to do a Destiny raid. Oh my god.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and I mean, back when I was still playing Destiny, I would watch... I would try and watch other casters doing raids so I could learn if I could try and do those live. And I was like, nope, those are way, that's a mess. I won't be able to do that. Never. Mm-mm. Can't do it.
Just, I'm backing away. Yeah. So outside of actually like Twitch itself and you figuring things out for you, whether it be tech or otherwise, as far as personally for you, what was one of your hardest things to overcome in streaming on Twitch?
It still pops out. I used to have a serious rage problem with games. Like, if something wasn't going my way, I got fucking angry. And not only when you're streaming can games go wrong, but your stream can go wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Your
sure.
equipment can go wrong. Your environment can go wrong. And so one of the things that, like, when I told myself, like, I was like, okay, I'd like to try this streaming thing. I was like, I will not be one of those people that shows up on Reddit punching his monitor. Like, I do not want to be one of those people. That's not how I want to present myself. That's not how I want to be known. That's not how I want my family to find out if I broadcast, if they ever do. Like, this won't happen to me. And so I worked like super, super hard to kind of combat that. And sometimes it comes through. It's come through a lot, not necessarily the rage, but the saltiness has come through a lot during Dark Souls 1.
we've seen some of that firsthand.
Yeah, exactly. And then the other one would be self-esteem. I would just say that, like, I probably had pretty low self-esteem as a teenager, and it pretty much continued downhill until about age 28 or 29. And so it's kind of like picking back up. And so, I always like being humble, but I also don't want to seem like an emo kid, even though that's who I am deep down inside.
Oh yeah. let me get a quick show of hands. Who's the emo scene kid in chat? Let me see you. when I first started streaming, one of my biggest things was I always streamed with my buddy DJ Arrow, and mm-hmm. we'd do a bunch of co-op games together. We'd play Overwatch. We got into Destiny together back in the day. Did Tekken together all the time. He's actually the one that started Tekken Tuesday with me, mm-hmm. and him and I are still to this day like the best of friends. But every time you see the two of us, whether it be me in his chat, him in my chat, or one of us in somebody else's chat, he will make the joke, oh, there's Mr. Pip Darty. Where's his chain wallet? Because I showed him one photo. I showed him one photo of me wearing trip jeans with a chain wallet, and it has not stopped since then.
Yep. There's a couple of old ones floating around. I think I've shared with the community, but I worked really hard to delete them. Now I'm like... Now,
they don't
like,
go away, Joe. They don't go away.
No, they don't. But at the same point, like, you get to a point where, as a creator, at least I went to this, where at first I was worried about people making fun of me. And then I realized if somebody makes fun of me, they're thinking about me, and that can actually grow my fucking channel.
Right.
And so there were like things that I would start to let happen. You know, that's why I shot a little poop candy into my mouth yesterday. That's why I the bunny ears thing doesn't bug me. That's why, like, you know, so much of my content is revolved around this idea that, like, you know, it's okay. I'm not going to take myself that seriously. You know, I'm here to drink beer, have fun, and play video games. And if that's something that you want to do as well, we'll grab a seat.
And that's kind of one of the things that, because when we raid somebody, typically we don't really say a whole lot about it here in the Shield Wall. But when mm-hmm. we come across the content creator that's just like, I wouldn't say like really resonates with what we try to do here, but like honestly really does. Like really resonates what we try to do here in the Shield Wall and why basically I was told to get you on an episode of Let's Chat. Is that like you found pretty much the, in my opinion, the best way to really market like, hey, I am just a guy that's gonna drink booze on stream and hang out with people and play video games. And
yeah,
if you want to sit here and crack jokes about me, cool. If you want to talk shit about me, that's fine too. But if you step out of line, your ass is grass.
And that's where I'm really lucky, where my income doesn't, or like my future doesn't rely on the income of this stream. I'm full well happily, like happy to ban somebody who is not worth my time. I'm not afraid. Like it doesn't spook me. I'm not like, so I have one less viewer this month. Okay. Well, I'll get it back next month.
Right.
Like, and so it's important to, how do I say, like, it's important to have serious boundaries, but to make sure that you're not always serious.
Yeah, the one thing I've noticed, because like I know a couple of people that have actually just recently went full-time content creation and just quit their day, like literally quit their day job. The most important thing that I've noticed in watching them make that transition, and some of them are even like going back to full-time streaming and YouTube and such, you know, from having to, you know, start streaming full time, realize, oh shit, I can't really make ends meet. I'm going to quit and go get another job and still stream. And then they said, all right, I feel like I'm in a spot now where I can go back to it. When they've gone back to it, they've had a lot more of a, as you said, like it just, I don't particularly care. So for me, I've seen firsthand, like you legitimately, sure, even if your livelihood depends on the amount of people who are clicking subscribe. To be honest with you, if somebody's in your stream and they're just ragging on you the whole time, they're probably not going to click subscribe anyways.
Exactly,
so,
yeah.
So they're just there to receive a gifted sub, if anything. And there's millions of other people that can get that gifted sub if somebody so happens to do so. But it's just, when it comes to content creation, you really can't take yourself that seriously. And it's really weird for me to say, because I'm somebody that takes myself way too seriously.
Yeah.
Like the second something goes south on stream, I'm just like, all right, this is my career. Bye, guys.
Yeah. I get very, very flush. I start getting like really rosy really quickly. And Cal and chat's there. So during our last front page stream, we got 7,200 followers in less than a minute. Because somebody decided to view bot the channel.
Ugh.
Or follow bot the channel.
That's the worst.
And yeah. And I was like, okay, I've got two, and this was like the first time, you know, I've had like issues in chat, issues with people in chat, like having to ban people, having to call people out, that kind of stuff live before, but never in front of that many people in a situation that I took as seriously. Because if I'm doing a front page stream where I'm like making all the cocktails, I do want it to go well. That's like something that I'm like, I want this to hit well.
Oh yeah, because you don't want Twitch seeing you like kind of fumble and make an arse out of yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And I was sitting there
in the bad way.
Yeah, and I was sitting there. I was like, well, I've got an option. I can freak the fuck out about this, or I can mute the alerts and just keep going. And we muted the alerts, and I think we ended up even hiding. I think we ended up hiding the alerts as well, like just getting rid of them and apologizing to anybody who ended up supporting the channel more, because none of them showed up. But it was just like, listen, it's fine. And what they want, what these people want, is attention.
Oh, yeah.
That's why they're doing this. They want to see me freak out. They want to see me angry. They want to see me fumble. They want to see me flush. They want to see me fail. And you succeed by forcing through it. And I mean, they haven't given up. We're still getting follow botted on my channel.
Ugh.
I get between 10 to 20 fake follows a week from this person who is either pathetic or they, for some reason, think they're helping. I haven't figured it out yet. And it's just sad. But the reality is like, this is, that's the desire, is to take something from you. And when you give them that success, that's how they win, by getting it. So,
also, if that person is watching the stream right now, I know we just got done saying don't feed the trolls, but hey, you guy, you, okay? that is all. That's all you're getting out of me, at least.
Yeah.
angry, you know, this ain't and Dark Souls.
Yeah, so Shatter has been helping with the Dark Souls, and he was really excited for me to jump into the Dark Souls franchise. He's a Monster Hunter veteran. I mean, just third-person action RPG legend himself.
I was going to say, I've noticed that, like, if you like Dark Souls, most of the people that I've met through streaming, if you like Dark Souls, you've either played or both played and love Monster Hunter and vice versa to an extent.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just like, okay, I'm just going to live here. I'm going to live in this little microcosm of all the Soulsborne streamers. And
well, and it's like, so when it comes to like third-person action RPGs, especially iframe-enabled, there just aren't that many.
True.
There's
a couple like Code Vein and stuff like that that are like okay, but they don't really scratch the same itch.
Yeah.
But and yeah, you're right. We don't have access to a lot of variety in that field.
Yeah. And I mean, I think the games that have done well and carved a spot out in that genre, they did it in the best way possible. I mean, Monster Hunter is a 14-year-old franchise at this point. It has been released on most of the modern day consoles. It has been re-released on different variations of the same game, you know, between it's like what, half-tiered releases between like I don't even know how to describe it, right? Like they'll do like a version and they'll do another version which like a couple extra monsters or something like that. And so it carved itself out that in this huge arena. And then Dark Souls did the same thing. I mean, Dark Souls 1 is an old game by this standpoint. It got the remaster, but it's still an old game. People are still streaming it. I mean, if I pull up on Twitch, like the amount of mostly single player games or multiplayer light games that are on average above 5K viewership on Twitch, there aren't that many. And I think Dark Souls like continually does that.
Yeah, and I think the only one really that we're going to find like that, I mean, it's starting to die off now, is The Last of Us 2.
Oh, I mean, but that won't stay for long.
Oh,
I mean,
no, not at all.
That's just a release. And so
I mean,
it's
in
clear
some respects,
that
not even Sekiro has really had that kind of staying power, really. Which is
kind of weird to say. So I'm going to play Sekiro. I haven't played it yet.
Likewise.
But the thing that actually, you know, I'm not excited about Sekiro is you get one weapon or one weapon type.
Yeah.
And to me, I think you kind
of
lose
that's
something
not a pole
doing
arm
that.
Of any kind.
It is not a fucking shaft. It's not a shaft.
Zhao likes his shafts.
I do. In fact, you know, we'll do that. That is a life-size war pike my wife and I made.
Holy
for
shit.
A dance video I did where I wore nothing but a gold Speedo and a t-shirt.
God, I have not seen this.
Yeah, so I put that on my... So that was probably... that was when the first... How do I say this? And I want to go back to what Shattersong said, because I think there's a lot of truth there. That is one of the very, very first kind of steps I took to where, like, okay, I'm going to be this brand, and I will not be taken... Like, I'm not going to take myself too seriously, but I will take the brand seriously. And I knew as a person who was... as a full-time job, but couldn't afford to just buy everything for the stream right out. The deal was, listen, I want to try and get some emotes made. I want to get a second monitor because I was only streaming with one monitor at the time. And I need a new webcam. So if we raise $500, the deal was I will make a Warpike and I will dance in a golden Speedo. And looks like Cal's going to link the video right there. And so that was the deal. And I think, you know, the community went fucking crazy. They did it really quickly. And so I made that video.
I'd have fucking broke my PayPal clicking that donate button.
Yeah. And it is... It was magical, you know? And it was really funny. There's this story at my first time going to PAX. I ended up getting to go because Dauntless provided me a ticket. And I met with the developers there. It was like my first time meeting them all in person. And the community manager at the time pulled me aside and says, "Hey, Kogath, who is a monster hunter."
Oh, we know Kogath, yeah. Well. Yeah. We hung out with him at Monster Hunter Festa.
Yeah, Kogath forwarded me your video, and I was like, "Holy shit, I'm sorry." He was like, "Yeah, except for the fact that I assumed it was a Warpike tutorial, and I forwarded it to the combat team so they could watch it." So he didn't watch it, he just forwarded it to the combat team so they could learn what I have to say about the Warpike. And when I first met the CEO at Phoenix Labs, he shakes my hand and he goes, "Don't worry, they told me not to watch the video."
We're going to take a quick sidebar real quick, and we're going to watch this.
So, before you do, that song that plays is Sexual Seduction by Snoop Dogg, and it will get copyright. It will be muted. So I urge you to listen to it. Okay, there you go.
I can live with that. Oh my god.
Now, I'm not that big.
Yeah, don't need to be modest. Don't need to be modest. You know, I think I might have to play Warpike now.
Yeah, it's it was
I mean, just look at those combos, man. Just look at those combos. Maximum. Listen, maximum deeps.
This is a no-hit run, if you know what I'm saying. Right. Yeah, so
whew.
And I think that was like the reception of this video, and it was kind of funny because at this point in time, the Dauntless closed beta scene, this was like mid, almost open beta. It was a really, really small scene. Maybe it had 150 viewers on average. And most of the streamers watched it live when it launched. And there was a screenshot from the directory. And like... 90% of the streamers were their directory. The directory was just this video on like 90% of the streamers.
The Zhao takeover.
Yep.
This is absolute fucking gold.
Yeah, so that was just like, you know, and I feel like once I did this, you know, it's all
all downhill from here.
As far as embarrassment goes, you can't get any lower than that. Right. So, you know, and I realized, like, you know, there's, and I brought up like self-esteem, like, there's a lot of power in voluntarily putting out something that is way worse than anybody can try to hurt you with.
Right. Like, it's not the warp bike tutorial, but a warp bike tutorial.
Yeah, there you go. Like, you know, you can't come in and try and attack my sexuality here. Like, you're not going to hurt me with that. Like, I will DM you this video if that's how you want to try and play it, right?
Right.
You can't hit me with anything. You can say I suck at games, and I'm like, all right, well, keep watching streams, and I'm just going to keep on streaming. You know, like, I just, like, you can...
Oh, my God, dude, when you told me that you were only going to play freaking pole arms in Dark Souls, I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's, well, and that's something I learned, right?
Me, I was like, motherfucker.
Yeah, and that's, well, that's something I learned, like, with, you know, because, like, I originally started... So, the reason that came up is, like, with Warpike, so I look up at it. I was the first person to main it, create content around it, and how do I say this? Not the best, because I never was, and I never claimed to be, but I was the first personality that claimed it. And my goal, and this is where my SEO, marketing, and public relations background comes into play, is I don't have to be good at it. I just have to be associated with it and be okay at using it. So that was where I just went 100% into it. I only use this. And I ended up getting really lucky because no other streamer used it. I ended up, because I played it launch day, I was part of the conversation where I was helping people figure out some of the more confusing mechanics involved with it back when the weapon was way harder to use. I was there in the conversation every step of the way. And as a part-time creator who's still looking to grow, you have to find a way to be in the conversation even when you're offline. Many creators do that with YouTube, right? Where they're like, hey, I may be offline, but I've got this YouTube video. I took a route which will not work for most people because I was only playing one game and I said, I will be part of this conversation. So even if I was offline, there would be somebody on Twitch asking about the Warpike and they would eventually get pushed to me. And that was an early part of my growth strategy and it worked out incredibly well. That's how I got partnership. That's how I got, not Twitch partnership, obviously a Dauntless partnership. That's how I received all of my early success. And Shatter has been there since the beginning. Cal has been there since the beginning. And it's even to the point now where I don't stream the game as much. I think I've streamed it twice in the last like 2 or 3 months. And I'll go into a chat and they're like, oh, you're the Warpike guy. And I'm like, I have no idea who you are.
Right.
Hi. What do you need? You know. And
who are you and how do you know of my work?
Yeah, and, you know, and that's kind of just where that early kind of stuff paid off. And it worked. It worked. It didn't help. Let me phrase this. It didn't help the weapon, but it helped me. That the Warpike went from being really, really good in closed beta to being utterly fucking terrible. So that meant the small amount of people who wanted to know how to use it had less places to go, because even though the game grew, the weapon was still largely unpopular. So even though my influence over the game kind of stalled as I stepped away from it, my influence with the weapon stayed because nobody else was there. The 5 or 6 people who are without a doubt way better at the Warpike than I am, they don't really make content that is accessible because that's not what they try to do.
Right.
the two main ones are speedrunners, and they don't produce any sort of, how do I say this? Their content is not designed for education. It is purely to show off a specific thing, and that's it. And
you know, it's funny, you and me have a lot in common there, because I main Hunting Horn and Monster Hunter, and not a single soul. I mean, I know maybe like two people in the entirety of Twitch that main Hunting Horn. So I was like, all right, we're gonna play some chin music, guys. We're gonna be the battle bards together. And I, you know, to this day, I still can't really find any guys. If any of you in chat are Hunting Horn mains, hit me up.
I know that. I mean, he doesn't play, so he's much more variety. But there's an amazing guy named Seabats, and about every 6 months he jumps back into Monster Hunter, and he loves the Hunting Horn.
I have to hit him up.
Yeah, he's a good dude. He's a good dude.
I'm trying to get like a whole lobby of just battle bards.
There you go. There you go.
All the dudes.
Yeah, and so that's just kind of it's just been how I went about it. And because of that success is why I do what I do in other games. If I can use a spear, I'll do that. If I can't use a spear, I'll look for one of the least popular, play styles, and I will guarantee that, right? So, Dark Souls 3 was easy because everybody told me I shouldn't use spears, and I'm like, well, that's really obvious. I guess I'm going to use spears. And then if I... In Destiny 2, it was like, oh, nobody likes the dual side, the sidearms, so I'm obviously going to use sidearms.
Yeah, those weren't even the sidearms, like in Destiny when I started playing, were just like, you had two that were like even halfway decent, and the one was like extremely good, and the other was like, oh, well, if you got nothing else.
I had two, and I never really compared the stats, because I never really got that high into the... I never really got that far into Destiny. Like, I never did any raid content. I mean, my light level was, you know, in the whatever high tier for when I played was. But I found a couple that worked, and those are just what I used. And then I played a little bit when that exotic sidearm with the laser came out. And it was like a one-hit shot laser where you had to like charge it, and it would just go. Forgive my sound effects there.
I know, it's fine. It's great.
It was just something that I realized, like, if you can be found, and you do something different, and you do that different thing well, people will respect that and follow that. People want to be involved in that. I think there's a natural love for the underdog in most situations. But the key is the underdog has to seem like there's a chance, right?
Right.
If it's like, you know, a baby versus, I don't know, what's the name of the boxer who bit that dude's ear off.
Mike Tyson?
Tyson, there you go. If it's a baby versus Tyson, I'm betting on Tyson. I'm sorry. I don't care how much of an underdog that baby is. He's not winning. Like, but the underdog's got to have a chance. And so if you look at this platform, if you look at content creation like a competition, because on some level it is, not just against other streamers, but against YouTube, against Netflix, against... I mean, I was going to say Mixer, but fuck, you know, Instagram TV, Reddit has live streaming now. Every single platform is getting some sort of live streaming element that is now in direct competition with the space that you're trying to take up. And not only is that space becoming more crowded, it's inherently becoming less searchable because there's more avenues that we're less relevant on, right? Every day, another live streaming site enters Google, right, in the Google sphere. So that means it's another click somebody might have to do to find you. And people don't like clicking. They like going where they went before. And so that's kind of like a philosophy that I've held in all of my content creation is be okay, be at least okay. And do something that catches the eye. And that's one reason why I ended up going with the green screen. I used to stream. I mean, never mind that my background is not nearly as flashy as yours, which might change. But I realized, like, wearing the ears with a background, I would have to have my background kind of small. My camera would have to be kind of small because there would be so much else going on. And that means the ears are taking up less of the space that I'm trying to show off. However, if I can delete my background, I can be bigger. Therefore, the ears are taking up more of the screen. And that means the gimmick, essentially, that I'm going for can be highlighted more.
Yeah.
And
I mean, when I started streaming, I actually had one of those like web arounds, like the over the chair green screens.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that worked great. But for me, I was always like, I'm a bit of a collector of sorts, so I have all this shit. I have fucking all my Monster Hunter art over there and shit like that. And I was just like, I kind of just, hello. I was like, I just need to show off my fandoms a little bit more. And it's a conversation of sorts. For me, I was like, you know what? When I get out of the space that I was originally streaming in, I'm just not going to do the green screen. I'm just going to try to come up with something flashy to do for the background. Every once in a while, I'll bust out the green screen. But for me, in some ways, I felt like claustrophobic using a green screen. Because like I'd go back and I'd watch my VODs and I'm like literally just sitting here like, okay, we're going to play some Dark Souls, guys. And I'm like, for some reason, subconsciously, I'm just trying to like crunch myself into the smallest corner of my screen. That might be a little bit of a self-conscious thing because it's like, okay, there's nothing else on this screen other than the gameplay to distract the viewer from me. Mm-hmm. But then when I decided to just go for this whole backdrop thing, I was like, sure, this was fucking expensive, but this also just allowed me to have a bit more of it. Even if I don't use it, like even if I have the green screen up, I'm just like, I know that I'm in my creative space surrounded by my fandoms that I've spent decades accruing. So for me, it was more of kind of like a mental thing of like, this is more so for me. I don't give a fuck if you guys like it or not kind of thing. Well,
and I mean, if we're looking at like, you know, the larger creators, more and more of them are moving toward that kind of atmosphere.
Yeah.
Because it's an opportunity to show off personality. It's an opportunity to show off more of who you are. It's an opportunity to connect with somebody, right? Whereas like, and I'm going to sound different here in a second as I switch microphones, so give me a moment. Where like, I'm literally working in a space where I need to be able to stand here and then be able to walk around over here as I do my talking streams.
Right, right.
And then, nice little nut shot there. and
charge,
so it's
chat,
like
free of charge.
And so it's like this situation where I was like, okay, I want room because I want to be able to walk around. I have to be able to like eliminate the wall behind me because behind me is just a bed. This is so the one deal with me using this space with my wife was, I can have half the room, but it needs to have a spare bed, and it needs to be able to become a spare bedroom quickly. And so that's the... So this is just... my green screen's just on a wire. I can take the wire down, take off the green screen, and all you'd see is a couple hooks in the wall. The lights can collapse, and I put them in a box. I can fit my green screen, my auxiliary lights, and all the cables for my lighting in a 1x1x1 box, and I can put it away.
Nice.
Obviously, I'm not taking down all the lights. I'm not taking down all the cameras. Fuck that shit. I'm not setting that up all the time.
Oh, that'd
be
a fucking nightmare.
So we've had complaints like, hey, can I cover these cameras? Because like people are literally sleeping in a room where three cameras are pointed almost directly at them, which is creepy. So, you know, like,
what is actually happening in this room?
Yeah. So if I've got, mostly like if a younger lady is staying here, I will make sure all the cameras are covered, because that just gives me the heebie-jeebies at that point. And it's a comfort thing, right? Like, you walk in here, and I don't know how many people come into your streaming space, but when people walk in here, initially they're like, what the fuck is all this? What's going on in here? Because I don't tell a whole lot of people what I do. I'm just not very interested in most people knowing this about me. I worked at my job for more than a year before somebody found out who I was, and that was because they happened to find my Twitter. So
now, is that just more of like a privacy thing for you, or
how do I, like, so do you know who the author David Sedaris is?
Yes.
Do you, like, have you heard David Sedaris talk about how much his family hates him?
I can't say that I have, no.
David Sedaris' family fucking hates him. They don't trust him. They won't tell him anything. Because if they tell an embarrassing story, what is the first thing he fucking does?
Pops it in a book.
Yeah, he puts it in a book. They feel like their entire life is on display. I like being able to share my work stories. I like being able to share family stories. I like being able to share things that most people might find kind of embarrassing if people knew about it. But I don't name names. I don't do anything. You know, like, so I want to avoid that situation as much as possible. And I'm sorry if I see you do something weird at work and I'm like, oh, that's good content. I'm taking a mental note and I'm going to talk about that on stream. And, you know, I think most people would be better off if they didn't know that. So it's like, it's a mixture of that. Plus, one of the things that happens, like, one of the things that I think is, like, listen, like, you hired me. You did not hire Januaryandon. Januaryandon is none of your fucking business. I don't want my boss to know it. I don't want any, like, it's none of my employer's business who the fuck Januaryandon is. As long as, like, I do my responsibility at work, like, I just prefer to keep something separate.
That's fair.
Luckily, so, and I've had multiple bosses. One was really weird about it, and the other one was a former content creator. So, I've been very lucky where I'm actually in a spot where I have a boss right now who
kind of
gets it. Yeah. So it's kind of, and it's the crapshoot, man. Because another thing about employers is they inherently want more of your time than they're willing to pay for, like. They all want more time. They want more work to get done. They want more stuff. And I really value my time, especially since I sell my time to my main job, and then I come and donate more time for my stream. Like, there's not a whole lot of fucking time left. So I'm really gentle, or I'm really, like, not gentle. I'm really stubborn about how much time my employer gets. And the more power they have, the more knowledge they have, the more power they have. And so I'm just kind of private about it. And I don't want them worried about what I do in my off time. Like, it's
none of their business, yeah. Like you said.
Yeah.
That's a good way to look, like, at it.
That and, like, right? Like, I don't want to be known as the office drunk. And all it's going to take is one out of context clip of me chugging a beer on camera. And people will make up their own assumptions from that, right?
Right.
So it's like, it's that fine walk. It's that fine line, right? It would depend, right? Like, yeah. I'm blabbering now.
Oh, no, dude, you're fine. No, I'll drink to that. Everybody knows here I go on rants. Skull. So, since we've officially labeled you the best bartender on Twitch, I have a personal question for you.
Okay. Let's get personal.
Have you, is that quite the personal you might be thinking, but have you personally taken any interest in homebrewing at all?
So it's kind of funny. Yes. The man I call my father, we used to brew beer together, and he's the reason why I love beer so much. Part of the reason beer is my brand is to honor my dad. Yeah. So it's a very serious part of my life.
Amen.
I don't do it as much anymore because beer was always a little difficult for me, and now I live in a small apartment.
So it's even more difficult.
Yeah. I do occasionally brew some Korean rice wine that I learned to make in Korea. And it's really easy.
I wanted to ask you about that. Huh. Was that for work or like what got you there? Like,
oh, Korea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We kind of like skimmed over it completely.
Yeah, for sure. I had just gotten out of college. I got a job. It was a terrible job. I got fired from said job, moved, was looking for work, ended up doing work that was not what I intended to do. And my wife was working, I don't know, like 15 hours a week for $8 an hour or something like that. You know, we were both like in a situation where we're kind of just like, what are we going to do? And she was like, hey, I hear you can get a job teaching in Korea really easily. And we're like, all right, well, you know, let's see how this goes. Let's think about it. We put in our applications. Within 2 weeks, we had an interview. And within 72 hours, we had a job.
Well, damn.
Teaching English. And we were like, all right, well, goodbye. So we lived over there for 2 years. We taught at the same school. And it was really neat. It was really neat.
So
and that's where...
Paint the timeline for us as to like your transition, culture shock and whatnot, moving there, not only moving there, but then moving back.
Yeah. So moving there was really, really welcoming. Seoul, South Korea is probably, I say this being completely ignorant of any other large city in the world, but Seoul, South Korea is one of the most non-English speaking countries in the world. Every single major sign will have English somewhere on it as well. Every app has, every major Korean app has an English variant. If you're in the greater Seoul area, you will find somebody who speaks some English. If not, Koreans have no problem speaking through Google Translate. They will literally hold up a phone and go back and forth with you. I met somebody. It was okay. So this is really funny. One of the guys, one of my best friends that I met in Korea. It was really, really. I would get done teaching. I would get done teaching an hour before my wife did. My schedule was just earlier. And there was a bar about two blocks from our school. So I'd be like, you know what, babe, I'll be at the bar. All you got to do is come get me, then we'll walk home. And I would go to the bar and I would have a couple beers because drinking in Korea is really cheap. A pint of beer at a bar was like $3, if that.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, and you could just sit there all fucking day.
It's like when I went to Costa Rica, I couldn't find shit to do half the time because of the weather. So I was like, I'm just going to sit in the hotel, and beers were like fucking a quarter. I was like, done.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I would get there about 4 and the bar would be practically empty. And the manager, who was a little bit older than me, but he would come and he would sit with me if nobody else was in the bar, and he would ask me questions. And what he would do is he would talk in Korean to his phone. And he would translate to me, and then I hold up his phone, and we would have entire conversations back and forth through Google Translate. And he would do this all the time. And
can you imagine finding somebody in the U.S. with that kind of patience? Nope.
Well, yeah. And so finally, one day, I said, hey, are you sure you're not busy? And he responded with, in Korea, we don't drink alone. So he felt bad for me for being alone in a bar at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And he was culturally required to sit with me. And I was like, dude, you have no idea how comfortable I am drinking alone. Like, you have no idea. It's okay.
Oh, man. Mm. I meant to show off slash flex this on stream. This is the first batch of mead I ever made. About 5 years ago.
And it's still good?
Oh, yeah. Mead doesn't go bad.
Really?
As long as you get it above 8.5%, it doesn't really spoil.
Okay. I was going to say, what's the ABV? That was my next question.
This one's clocking at 12.
Nice. Nice. That's really cool.
And I usually don't even do a whole glass of it, mainly because I was just like, you know what? I tend to drink my mead a little too quick to let it age properly, but I said I'm going to keep this one bottle, and it's going to it's going to be uncorked when I feel it's an occasion for it. And you know what?
Hey, there you go.
This has been one of the most entertaining and relaxed interviews that I've done with content creators. No disrespect to anybody that's been on an episode of Let's Chat prior, but let's just say I was a little bit more nervous than most. But this has definitely been more than enjoyable. Yeah. And you have stories for days. Sure. My goodness. Skull.
You know, Oh, sorry. Gumbe. There we go.
Damn, you really...
I don't know.
Do get better with age, I tell you. You're gonna sit right there. Jow, I'd give you a horn of this right now.
I'd love to have it.
I mean, you saw on Twitter what I just got done brewing, guys. You can look down below and see what I just got done bottling today. My floor is still sticky. My folks fucking hate me right now. I'm going to have to mop it up one more time after we're done here.
Yeah. But yeah, man, it's just like, I don't know, like one of the few things that I got kind of good at is I got okay at like holding on and being able to tell a story, which is ultimately why, like, I think why I failed at YouTube videos, because I never tried telling a story. I was like, oh, attack this one twice, then roll to the left and right click, and then hit your Q button, and then stand to the left. You know, I would do like these really, really dry guides, and it's just not me.
Right.
Like, and looking back at it, that's not the person I want to be anyway. It's never been the content I wanted to produce. I would much rather somebody come to my stream to laugh than to learn. If they learn while they're there, then let's go.
Well, but I can tell you one thing for sure. Me inviting you on this podcast of sorts was definitely more of a, I don't really get that often of an opportunity to hang out at length in your stream.
Mm-hmm.
And I've learned a lot from the few times that I have been in your channel. Even about myself that I wasn't aware of previously.
Yeah.
And some of the things that I've taken from you as advice have genuinely improved my content and the relationship I have with the people in this chat right now.
Yeah.
And I can definitely say thank you for that. And pretty much, I can definitely say if people actually pay attention to your mannerisms and your phrasing in your streams, and some you have a way of just throwing quick little one-liners out there that are entire hour-long TED Talks over the course of a short sentence. That if you really sit down and reflect on some of the things that you have said on your stream, speak miles in terms of education for somebody. And the past 2 weeks have been kind of proof of that for me.
Yeah, and I think the last 2 weeks have been fucking brutal with some of the things that have come out light on social media.
Oh, yeah.
And a number of the people who turned out to be predators helped me, got me game keys, got me into parties, got me contracts, helped my stream. And I think it's both like awful, disgusting, but at the same time, like such a drive to want to be better. And being in a position where I know what I've done, I know some of the negative things that I've done, but I also know where, what lines I've never crossed. And understanding that there are people in the space that will happily cross those lines. And not being one of them makes you somebody inherently worth listening to. And not being somebody who is in that situation and won't be act like that, you are somebody who has a responsibility to be better for the ones who will. Oh, yeah. And on some level, this is where I go back to, I don't take myself seriously, but I take what I'm doing seriously. You can be silly, but take it serious.
Yeah, I mean, and you really, like, in some respects, like, sure, people come to our streams for entertainment, but in some regards, we do kind of have a responsibility as content creators to really kind of just set an example. Because even if somebody doesn't directly say, hey, oh my God, I look up to this person, like, I want to be like this person, like, there's a reason why the button they click on above our streams is follow and then subscribe. Like, you are following this person to the T, like, you are a part of their community and what they're about, and you're subscribing to their ideologies and their, you know, their motives and their actions.
Yeah, and it's a bummer because, like, I don't know. That's the thing, right? Like, I don't, as a content creator, as a person with a platform. So, content creation aside, this goes with actors, celebrities, you know, elite rich people, stars, right? Even though obviously I'm nowhere near that stature, the fact that if I have one person listening to me, then the words I say matter a little bit more. And for every one person you have that listens to what you have to say, your words matter a little bit more. A little bit more worth gets lumped on there. Not necessarily a financial worth, not necessarily a worth that you'll ever be able to cash in on, but an influence of worth. And it's especially in a situation where I deal a lot with alcohol. I don't want somebody keeping up with me when I drink. I don't want some, you know, 18-year-old who got his mom's vodka, you know, pouring a, you know, whatever the fuck you mix randomly with vodka at an 18-year-old. What did I? Gatorade. There you go. I used to mix Gatorade and vodka all the time. I don't want some guy seeing me go, oh my gosh, I got to make another drink with January, right? Because I don't want an 18-year-old drinking as much as I do.
Oh no.
And so I think last night I fucked up. Because I really never try to talk about how much I've drank on stream. I don't show the bottles. I don't show, I don't keep a stack where people can see. I always move because I don't want somebody saying, oh my gosh, I need to do this too, or feeling like they should. And it's only in moments where, say, something really hyped just happened or something silly happened where I'll finish my drink or I'll toss the bottle or, you know, something really silly, like more theatrical. But I do what I can to not boast about that sort of thing, because this is not the goal. The goal, the idea isn't, oh my gosh, January drinks so much. The idea is I do this and what they see is, wow, I see January drinking, but he never throws up on stream. He never
blacks out,
does something disgusting. He never blacks out. He never trips. He never falls, right? Like, I'm very, very careful. In fact, Cal, my mod, he has the authority where if he sends me a DM and says, you're done, I end stream. I will not. If he thinks I've gone past a certain point, he DMs me and he can end the stream. He has the ability to raid my channel, like raid from my channel. He's a complete editor in the channel. I value that perspective. Like that perception. Not only do I not want to be seen as a drunk, I don't want to show people that this is what alcohol is used for. Because this is a young platform. These people are impressionable. They listen to the people on screen. And Yeah, and so, and that's a conversation Cal and I had 2 years ago, where I was like, listen, you send me the DM, and that's it. And he's called it before. And I respect the hell out of him for it.
He's done it once. Yeah.
I want to say it was Sea of Thieves, but it might not have been. I don't remember. And so it's just like, I give a damn what I put out into the world. In the same way that I don't want to litter on the planet, I don't want to litter in the Twitchosphere. So that's kind of the philosophy I go about it. And sometimes I'm right, sometimes I'm wrong.
Right. We all make mistakes, for sure.
You know.
And I mean, that's the other thing that I take a very high level of respect with you in, because for me, I grew up in a half Irish, half basically just Slavic family. So alcohol has just kind of always been around, always been a thing. So for me, we kind of take it as like a, this is a social thing. We're meant to enjoy this together within reason.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Type of thing. And I mean, sure, I've had a few moments where I definitely wish I had somebody like Cal that could have just pulled the plug on me, because I went back and watched the VOD like, ooh, Pip, no.
Yeah.
But thankfully, over the past few years, I've definitely fixed a lot of that. But yeah, you're 100% correct. Like, we, you know, Twitch is a younger platform, and we do have responsibility as content creators to really kind of present certain things that we do in a slightly different light.
Yeah. It's and you can't go wrong doing that. You will never lose out on being more responsible than you have to be. Like, as a business, you just won't. And I mean, this is where, like, I go sometimes super overboard on the responsibility. Like, I turned down a sponsorship with what is it? It's the energy drink from Razer.
Well, I didn't even know Razer had an energy drink. What?
Yeah. Hold on. 1 second. Razer energy drink.
Cal saying Respawn?
Respawn, that's it. Thank you, Cal.
Oh, they gave me samples at TwitchCon, and they gave me a fucking migraine.
Yeah, and I mean, they just, what, they're a sugar-free, basically, like, you know, energy drink. And I turned it down because I was like, listen, man, I work full-time. I stream late at night. I would never, in good conscience, be able to drink this, because I would be up until 3 or 4 in the morning if I drank this.
Right.
If I also don't really like energy drinks. If it's the morning time, I'm going to drink coffee. So I would feel weird, like, accepting any sort of
tea in the morning kind of guy.
Yeah, I was going to say, it would feel weird for this relationship, knowing that I could never really advocate me using it on stream. I did it, like, they sent me the box and I did it once, and I was up till like 3 in the morning. I'm like, well, this is stupid. Why did I do this? Like, why am I staying up till 3 in the morning for a free sample of this shit? And that was like, that was one of the times where, like, but at the same time, you know, that was probably being me overly cautious, but at the same time, that was me being like, well, I don't believe in this, so why would I?
Right.
Why would I take a sponsorship with this?
Yeah, we've had this conversation in my channel numerous times. Like, I had been approached by 2 other energy drink companies, and then I got approached by a health and fitness crew. It wasn't like, they didn't even have any kind of like dietary supplements or anything. They were literally just some like Instagram group that was like, oh, hey, you know, you got to promote our clothing line, and we have resistance bands and kettlebells. And I was like, have you seen my stream?
Yeah.
Do I even stand up on camera? No, I turn my camera off before I stand up. Like,
I've had situations like that where, like, I got something, you know, similar, and I was like, I don't know if you've seen my brand, but this shit don't make a goddamn bit of sense, so no thank you.
What was the last one? Mino, if you're in chat, help me out with this. What was it? It was some kind of coffee company where they literally take your logo or like pictures you have of your like merch and stuff, and they will print it on a bag of coffee beans, and then they'll handle all the shipping and shit. And I was like, I've openly said on stream that I fucking hate everything but the smell of coffee. I love the smell of coffee. I worked as a barista for about 8 years. So I want nothing to do with drinking coffee. I don't want to taste it. I will be around it. I love the smell of it. I will immediately perk up if I smell a cup of coffee brewing. But the second a cup gets put in front of me, I'm like, somebody else can have this. So I emailed them back. I'm like, guys, can we talk about this for a second? And they're like, oh, well, we didn't turn your stream on. We just saw that you were a content creator. I was like, then why the fuck are we having this conversation? Like,
well, that's the kind of shit that like I fucking, and that's, and to me, that's a red flag where I don't want to work with you.
Right.
If you, you know, if there's that much disconnect in our first message, then, you know, and like, I think for some reason my Instagram, which isn't very big, I don't know why, but I get the dumbest fucking shitty merch brands coming
Instagram
to my Instagram.
A weird place for that.
And it's to the point now where like I have a copy paste. I have like a copy paste text document that if I get a weird clothing brand Instagram message, I just copy paste, and it has all of my sizes and my PO box, and says, "Hey, I would love to work with you. You know, send me some products here, and I'll decide." And it's never worked because they're always like, "No, we want you to have an affiliate link, and then you can buy some of our clothing." And I'm like, "No."
Now, who does
and
that,
that's like,
who does that benefit? Oh, wait, you, not me. Okay, moving on.
That's where like, I don't know. As a brand, that's where shit started getting kind of weird for me. Because, 2 years ago, if you would tell me, hey, a brewery's going to box up some beer and send it to you, I would have lost my shit. I would have been like, what the fuck? A brewery wants to send me beer? Like, wait, really? And all I have to do is drink it on stream? Holy shit, let's go. Then, like, a year ago, if you would have told me that, I would have been like, holy shit, this is cool. Okay, maybe we can work together. Maybe something can go out. But now, if somebody wants to send me beer, I'm like, well, all right. But if I have to drink it on stream, you got to pay for that. Like, I'm sorry, that time's right. valuable. I'm sorry, I can sell that space. I already have.
Yeah.
And so, like, it's this weird where, like, I you have to stop, or I had to stop realizing they're reaching out to me, because they're not. They're reaching out to this, and they're interested in what's going on here. And I needed to understand that space has value. And if one company is willing to pay for it, then likely others are as well. And it's an interesting like situation to be in where, I mean, of course I want fucking free beer. I want beer all the goddamn time. Like, that's all I want to drink is free beer. But it's this understanding of, like, you know, who I am as a person, who I will drink all of the beer all of the time, any chance I get. But realizing what that free beer actually costs, and what that free beer, you know, what that comes with. So I go out of my way to buy almost all of the beer that I use on stream, with the exception of, you know, certain brands that we work out a deal. Because one thing that I do is I will not pretend I like your shit. Like, I won't. Like, I'm not going to sit there and be like, oh, yummy. Like last night, this is what we had. I don't know if my camera's flipped on your end. Oh, no, you flipped the camera. Nice. Mango Cart Golden Road Wheat Beer. This is, without a doubt, one of the worst beers I've ever had in my entire life. And if I had to pretend to like that stuff, I would hate myself. It'd be disgusting. I would feel dirty pretending to like this, because it was rancid.
Oh, God.
I still drank five of them. Oh. Because, you know, that's the, I bought it, I'm going to drink it. I'm also really cheap. If I bought it, I will drink it. I won't like it.
You and me have too many things in common, Jal. No, I have, oh no, here, take the mead. Drink this instead.
We do it. We do it. But and that was kind of cool. Because you know, I've worked with the funny thing I find is, like, all of the breweries have been super cool about it. It's the game devs that they're like fucking anal as shit.
Oh, I can imagine, yeah.
And I don't like it. We need another, yeah, another. But that's kind of fun, though, being able to do that, where you can go out and you can find a beer. Like, I knew this was going to suck. I don't like wheat beer. I knew this was not going to be for me, even if I objectively thought, okay, it's an okay beer, it's just not for me. I knew this was going to blow, and I bought it anyway, because it's content, right?
Gotta have that content, man.
Although, I never could have guessed how bad this shit is. This was unacceptably bad. God. Golden Road, if you're listening, don't fucking contact me. Don't fucking contact me.
When I first started getting into, like, really heavily homebrewing mead, I was actually just live streaming to my Discord. Like, hey guys, it's brew day. We're just going to shoot the shit and hang out. And then some tech issues happened with that. My phone literally just fucking started hating my existence being live on Discord for that long from my phone. So, like, all right, I'll wait till I get a laptop or something, and I'll do it that way. But no, that's kind of one of the things that I originally was doing, was I was actually reviewing cigars and beer on my stream.
Really?
While I was playing Hearthstone, because that's how I got into streaming. For the first year ish of me streaming, it was all card games, Magic the Gathering Online, and Hearthstone. And it would literally be me sitting in the attic of my parents' house, just fucking stogie in my hand, beer in my hand, like,
hey,
this cigar's good, this beer's good, you want to know why? I'll tell you why. And it was just, it was just some fat, fucking half-bald kid fucking smoking and then drinking all day.
Well, that's the thing, like, inherently, I take a lot of inspiration, especially lately. There's a YouTube channel called How to Drink, and he does a mixture of fandom related cocktails and modern cocktails and classic cocktails, and he's got a great setup. Yeah, and I mean, he inspired me in multiple ways. One, he used to be really, really serious about how he tried explaining how the cocktails taste, but there's an inherent difference in explaining a taste versus in experiencing a taste, which is why they're two different sensories, like hearing versus tasting. You will never get the mix. And so he mixes in, you know, silly and jokes in experiencing the taste, because you will never be able to describe how something tastes accurately. It just doesn't work that way.
Oh, yeah, no.
And that was something that I kind of like, was like, he's totally right. I still kind of try from time to time, and that's a mistake, but I understand that I'm like getting better at it. And then his quality is so good that I realized I would never be able to compete with that. And I need to completely and radically change how I do cocktails. I mean, he's got like a 4K super slow-mo camera. He's got lights. He's got 6 or 7 different camera angles. He can edit, right? It's not live. He doesn't do this live. He does it post. So, like, I realized that, like, this is what can happen in a perfect environment, and I can't recreate that live. So I need to go somewhere completely different with it.
Trying to think of how you could set up, like, a real-time slow-mo.
So,
it's not quite. I feel like,
okay, so the Logitech Stream Cam can do 720, 120 frames per second.
Okay.
And I
work with that.
I don't, but the thing that I don't know what you could do, I don't know if you could actually set up a live slow-mo feature in OBS. You could, at 120 frames per second, you can easily do slow-mo in post, but I don't know about recording slow-mo or playing it slow-mo.
You'd have to set up some kind of like live replay and then figure
out
a way
that
to
would
play
be interesting.
The live. Ooh, we might have to talk about that offset, Chow.
I mean, I don't have one of those cameras and I won't buy one because they did a USB Type-C connector. That's the only thing it has. And I have no business supporting that.
Fair.
That's the dumbest fucking thing I've ever heard in my entire life. One of the things that I think is kind of interesting, I would love to see the thing is when you tweeted that out today, the picture, I immediately went to your profile to wonder what the process looked like. And you only tweeted the before. Like when you washed the bottles, I guess.
Yeah.
And then after you filled them, I wanted to see what your setup looked like. I wanted to see what your...
Oh, dude, my setup is jank as fuck, which is why I really don't do anything like that right now.
Okay. It's okay. I mean, but the thing is like you say right now, right? So what you're thinking is maybe 10 years down the road, you got a nicer setup?
Oh, no. This is like end of summer project. Like I'm literally turning my basement into a brew house.
That's even better. People like progression. That's the shit people want
to
see.
You are not wrong, Joe.
I work in social media. Of course I'm not fucking wrong. Are you kidding me?
Like, I'll come over there, bitch. Don't you sass me.
God.
All right. Well, look. All right. You know what? Fine. You're right. I should do more.
Yeah, no.
I should do more progression.
And the thing that's more important is... if you just tweet out, you know, your what it looks like about 25 bottles. I can't really, I'm not going to count because I hate counting. people see that and they're like, damn, that's pretty neat, right? And then maybe they're like, oh, how does that do that? Home brewing setup. And then I'm just going to go to Google Images and you find a pretty weird array of images. Some on the more higher end, some are more akin to what I did when I was brewing, which is a Gatorade bucket and a couple 5-gallon buckets. And when you can show what you make with what you have, that builds a relationship.
True.
With the people interested. Yeah, if it's in a bathtub, don't show that.
Yeah, no.
Get
no.
something a little bit better.
No bathtub hooch here, Cal.
That's funny. But, right, it's just about the idea of... And then at the same time, this is where what you almost call evergreen content, where once you have that pictures, that image, that initial memory, that is now something that a year down the line, 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line, you do a... compare contrast, you do a I can't believe I use this, and lol look at my old setup. Like those images will work for you forever.
True.
And everybody knew they're gonna be like, wow, you went from that to this. Everybody who is already on your team goes, oh, I remember those days. Do you remember when you talked about this mead? Do you remember this story from this? Like it's just this.
Yeah, for me, I guess it's always one of those things of like I wasn't entirely sure. Because, I mean, for a while, we were a very, like, heavily Nordic-branded channel, so it was all mm-hmm. about the mead making, and as you can see, I mean, I fucking drink out of a horn on stream.
Yeah.
It was one of those things of, like, I wasn't too sure how heavily I was going to be into, like, how much of that was going to come from Twitter and Instagram over to the actual live stream and YouTube. So I guess I'm just still on the fence about like how much of that type of content do I want crossing over kind of thing.
So I think one thing, and if you don't mind getting into, some more industry related talk,
we're here to talk. It don't matter.
I also want to answer. I want you to answer Cal's question. What the hell do you do with that fucking horn?
So this is even more jank. So before I was using a wire hanger that was like bent around to like hold it up like this type deal. But every once in a while that wire hanger would just like droop if I put the horn down too full. So we, using some fucking hot glue and some cardboard boxes, they're actually unboxed. This was from the cardboard box that this microphone came out of. So fun lore there. We used some hot glue, and I don't know why I glued rocks to it. I just had some... Oh, you know what? These were originally from... the rocks that are glued on here were from some Warhammer terrain. I originally intended on spray painting this and making it look like it was just like a carved out rock for my drinking horn, and I just never got around to it. So this is literally just hot glue and cardboard and...
Hey. Ta-da. If it works, it works. Although, like I'm saying, that could be a pretty interesting piece if you ever get that done.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But the thing that I
like, it's cardboard. If I spill meat on it, it's kind of fucked.
You could seal it first, or try to. True. I don't really know how that would work, to be honest. I thought about it
before painting it, just like dunking it in a vat of Mod Podge.
True. There you go. So I have stopped hoping. I have stopped posting to Twitter with the hope that somebody sees that tweet and comes to watch me live. In fact, what I do, I hope my viewers have Twitter and they'll come follow me. My viewers on Twitch go the opposite. I want them to go the opposite direction. Because Twitter is, it's a very narrow pathway into who I am behind the scenes, who I am as a broadcaster, and my personality that I can't show live, right? So where I go, where what I do when I'm off camera, like all of that stuff, right? And I do this because not because I hope somebody sees that and goes, oh, this is somebody I want to follow. But the reality is the movers and shakers in this industry, whether they be larger streamers, whether they be content creators of various sizes, whether they be industry leaders, community managers, marketing influencers or influencer marketers, marketing or partnership and influencer partnership coordinators and shit like that. They don't have the time to browse Twitch, to be watching every single one of your streams. They don't have time to view everything that you are. So I put a healthy cross-section of what I am on Twitter, because the people who are on Twitter are not trying to watch streams. They're trying to do their job on Twitter and be involved in that space. And so what you do when you put out your meadery section, your brewing, what you're doing there is you're saying, do when you put out your meadery section, your brewing, what you're doing there is you're saying, I'm more than a gamer. And that's an attempt to, one, broaden who you are off stream to anybody who follows you already. And that tells brands and that tells influencer marketers that you are more than a gamer. And this space is currently saturated with the gamer marketers. It's done. Corsair can literally give a 50 viewer streamer a mouse, and that streamer feels lucky for some reason. That's the stupidest fucking thing. Don't ever fall for that, by the way.
Right.
You are worth so much more than a fucking mouse. All right?
Words of wisdom from Jao here.
But these other brands who are used to paying $5,000 for ads on 10 different websites, they realize that for $50 a month, they can get an ad on a stream. For $100 a month, they might be able to get an ad on a logo on a screen that pops up. Like, this space is going to be so attacked by marketing from every single facet of life. And it's starting with the alcohol industry right now. Bud Light just has esports teams now, or like his esports sponsorships and shit.
Yeah.
Voodoo Ranger, who I'm represent, like who sponsors me, they're now heavily getting into the space. I just did a cider sponsorship, and this is gonna continue.
And
so
then they had who is it? Miller Lite did the whole thing for,
yeah,
for moderators.
Miller is, I think Miller's with, yeah, the moderator for Twitch, Quan, and then I think they're involved in Overwatch. And this will continue, and it's just gonna keep coming. So like your idea with the mead, doing it yourself, having that kind of stuff, that's like a great place to start. That's a great place to, like, because I mean, who does that? You know, that's cool. That's fucking cool. That's cool shit. You know, 99%, that's a lie. 90% of people on this website put on a video game and try and entertain people, right? It's these little things that set you apart. It's these little ideas. And that's one thing that I've learned. It's like, it's a constant battle to like always be providing something that is different. I've got a friend on this platform. His name's Geef. He is an Australian broadcaster. No face cam, no overlay, no nothing. Man doesn't have a single fucking thing other than his voice and the best emotes on the platform. Now, he paid a shitload of, for like that. He went ham on his emotes, but the emotes aren't it. It's his voice. He capitalized on that. His fucking, I have it around here. I would have to dig it out. His business card says content creator, broadcaster, voice. That's it. Like, and then his little chicken emote. That's his fucking card. And this is like this idea where you need to continually set something up that is something that everybody can attach to. And, you know, channel brands, channel ideas, those are starting to kind of fall away as these personality traits are like becoming bigger. And these hobbies where you can connect to people are becoming bigger. And they should be, because those are real. Those are tangible.
Oh yeah.
That shit you can show people.
Well, I mean, as you saw, as you see on my pin post on Twitter, I am also a professional fire breathing instructor.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still trying to come up with a way to actually live stream that. Like, the only caveat there is I'm probably going to have to just wind up, you know, shelling out and getting myself a laptop sometime this year so that we can take the stream outside.
See, that is the big bummer.
Yeah.
With that kind of stuff. I'm trying to think something else you could do.
I mean, I could probably set something up like and just stream from my phone for a little while.
I mean, that depends on the phone, man. Some of those phone cameras are kicking ass.
I mean, my Pixel 2 is fucking great. I mean, all the pictures I snap for Instagram and Twitter and shit, that's all from that Pixel 2, so.
Maybe that's something you should try. But the issue with doing phone is chat. The chat interaction gets a little difficult.
That's all right, because I'm Mr. Tony Two Phones. Got one for chat, one for stream.
Because, I mean, like, the reality is, man, is our games will always be there. Our games will literally always be there. And we can always default to playing video games. But as creators, we have so much room that is so poorly
utilized
by the majority of creators. And it is a constant battle, because not all your ideas are going to work.
Oh no. And it's that fear of failure, I feel like, that keeps a lot, myself included, back.
I mean, yeah, I mean, definitely. So here's a failure that I learned from. What I used to do is, I used to play Dauntless for about 3 hours, and then I would, fuck you, Shatter, he just sent me a DM, and I opened it like an asshole, and it's a pair of shorts that says, stop staring at my cock with a rooster, exactly where you'd expect it to be. hold on, I gotta lower this, you bastard. I used to play Dauntless, and I would get my viewership up, right? Then I would hard swap to making a cocktail. And I would always lose a bunch of viewers, but that was how I would be like, okay, these people don't want to watch a cocktail, but they're wrong. I'm going to make it good and I'm going to force them to fucking watch it. And what I would do would be like, hey guys, don't go anywhere. I promise you, we're going to make this cocktail and we're going to come back. And what I ended up doing was I was so obsessed with that viewer count that I would throw together these cocktails and then I would jump back in to keep as many of the viewers as I could. And one, for the people who actually enjoyed the cocktails, they got a worse experience.
Right.
The people who weren't there for the cocktails left already anyway. So as a whole, the content was just worse. And then it broke up the flow of the gameplay. And I've, of course, since doing that strategy, I've obviously abandoned that strategy since then. But the idea is that, like, it is a touch and go. It is a learning experience. It is knowing that at any time you could say, do, you could present something where you chase people off. And that's part of the course. That's part of this journey. We're not perfect. And keeping every single damn viewer is rough and it's scary.
Not to mention impossible.
It's incredibly impossible. So it's, you know, it's working on your personality. It's working on being this multifaceted person where not only are you something on stream that's happening, but you're a reaction to what's happening on stream as well.
Oh, yeah.
And some games are better for that. Some content is better for that. And I mean, especially with such a visually pleasing profession, I feel like that is like should be a huge goal for you. Like, yeah, that would be cool. Like, yeah, that would just be enjoyable.
That's something that, because like for me personally, like I don't really have a whole lot of clients anymore anyways right now. Yeah. So actually being able to just do it in general would be great. I also just invested in a bunch of equipment to start playing music again because I'm a bassist. So that'll be something that I probably plan on doing on stream a lot more often. Is just if I need to take a quick break, just grab the guitar real quick and just jam out for a couple minutes and then jump back into it. Even starting to just kind of try to write my own little licks that I can play on stream, either on a BRB screen or something like that.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it's like, it's tough, know, because I mean, as this platform evolves, the game is becoming less and less important. And the broadcaster is becoming a bigger and bigger element. You know, you see, like, probably the quintessential example right now is XQC. The whole thing he does is he plays random-ass fucking games because he's going to react like a total fucking idiot to anything that happens.
Right.
And he knows it's going to get clipped and shared and moved and around. And I'm not saying follow XQC because that's a really fucking bad idea. But the idea is like as a creator, you are more important than ever in the history of live streaming, where gameplay alone, if you're not the top 0.1%, you're not going to, it just doesn't work anymore. It's not what people are here for.
Right. So we're heading up on time at this point, but I definitely think we've ended on a pretty damn good note, Jao.
Mm-hmm.
You guys should let me know in chat if you wanna see me get some homebrew meat over to Jao and have him make some cocktails with it.
Hey, even if you just want me to drink it, I'll send you my P.O. box.
Let's do it.
And I will happily drink that on stream, and I won't even make you pay for it.
I'll get you some mead, Joe.
Yeah, but, dude, let's talk. I will 100% review it, and you say I can uncork it and cork it again, and it will age. So I'll save some of it. I will.
Oh no! If you get a bottle from me, you always get two because you get one for now, one for later.
Okay, cool.
That's how we always do it.
Sold. I'll DM you my PO box. We'll get this done.
Now, we'll set that up on the side. But Jao, yeah, as in our usual Let's Chat fashion, I'm gonna open the floor to you. You have all of these lovely viewers to plug your shit to. By all means, have the floor.
because I got my name from a band that broke up and they weren't that big anyway, I completely own Januaryandon on Google. So just fucking Google it and click one of those links. Follow Mr. Pip. Encourage him to continue to try and post some of the cool shit he does, because that's what I want to see. Thank you for giving me your time. Thank you for giving a shit about me. And I'm really happy to have met you.
Thank you, and right back at you. Skull. And who knows, maybe one of these days you'll see Jao and I on another episode of Let's Chat. At the very least, I'll be seeing you in his chat. Thank you all. And of course, as always, my Vikings, may the gods be with you all. Skull.